Hi, good evening, and I'm James Goodale for the Digital Age. We got a great show tonight with a guy who should be in the Guinness Book of Records for editors. He has been the editor of Newsweek, New York Magazine, The Daily News, Esquire. No one can top that record, and no one ever will. We want to talk to him about how he did it. We also want to ask him, since he was editor of Newsweek, you know, what's going to happen to the news magazines? Are they going to make it or not? So, welcome, Ed Kosner.
Hi, Jim.
You've written a book.
I have indeed.
And here it is. It's News to Me. And then there's a little coda to that. The making and the unmaking of an editor. You have stayed at jobs and you have left jobs.
That's correct.
Sometimes under your own steam and sometimes not. And I guess that's what you have there for the coda. So I think, you know, we could do this show, hey, when you got bar mitzvahed, when you went to Newsweek, da, da, da. And I'm going to do a little bit of that, but I thought it'd be a little irreverent and do it another way. And I've got a little clip here I want to show you.
Okay. Ed has a sterling reputation. And, you know, he has created high levels of buzz and low levels of buzz. So, you know,
we'll medium buzz.
And moderate buzz.
And medium and moderate buzz.
Where did he create the high buzz?
Well, I think, you know, Ed, obviously, at New York Magazine, you know, you were huge and hot. I think Esquire was troubled, and I think the buzz was low. And I don't know if that has a lot to do with Hearst magazines or if it has a lot to do with your stewardship of the magazine, but the buzz levels in your career have varied, as they do in all careers.
Well, there's a quick summary of your career. That's Alex Kaczynski.
Right.
At that time, she was the media reporter for the New York Times.
Correct.
And so I suppose the question to you is, do you agree with the buzz level that she applied?
Emphatically.
Emphatically,
yes. I thought I was very successful, and New York Magazine was very successful when I did it. Newsweek was very successful when I did it. And the Daily News had a good success while we were doing it, particularly because the news, the lowercase news, cooperated so much. Esquire was a fiasco for me. I wasn't suited to do that work, and the magazine had its own problems, and it was not a happy combination.
Okay, well, what do we mean by buzz? Would you agree? Two questions. What do we mean by buzz? And two, do you agree with her that the most buzz was at New York, and why?
Well, buzz is a concept that was coined by Tina Brown.
Who is?
Who is the former editor of Vanity Fair and The New Yorker, where she created a lot of buzz. And then the editor of her own magazine called Talk, where she created zero buzz. So she was hoist by her own buzz, or In any event, buzz means the kind of chatter that's generated by a magazine that draws a lot of attention to itself, sometimes by the quality of the magazine and sometimes by things that just happen. New York Magazine created a lot of buzz, but when I was the editor of Newsweek and during the Watergate period and thereafter, the concept of buzz didn't exist. But had buzz existed, Newsweek had a lot of buzz in those days.
Well, talking about New York Magazine, New York Magazine's always been an interesting magazine. It was started by Clay Felker. It's the prototypical city magazine. Everyone knows what it is. Sometimes you wonder, you know what it is, but you sometimes wonder what's going to be in it. Is it going to be news? Is it going to be entertainment? Is it going to be entertainment and news? And if you look at that magazine, is that a news magazine or is that a magazine that provides entertainment? What's the scoop?
I used to call it a topical magazine, which meant that it would do the news when the news was appropriate and interesting, but it also found news in subjects like exciting new neighborhoods, new entertainment stars, trends of all sorts. The most fun I had doing New York Magazine were the trend stories that we developed. And some of the trends were very exciting at the time, but when you think about them now, they were quite evanescent. There was one called Forever Single, when people were convinced that people would never get married again. Well, that went by. There was another famous story we did called Downward Mobility, which was about the fact that people weren't living as well or doing as well as their parents did. Now, to some extent, that's still true, but a lot of people who were of that generation made a lot of money and did very well. We did a cover called Restaurant Madness, which was about the first great outbreak of restaurants around New York and the mania for food. So, and we even did one called Forget the Hamptons, Now It's Country Chic. But if you notice, the Hamptons are still there. So not all these trends were so solid, but at the same time, they caused a lot of interest. People liked them.
Now you had your first boss there, overall boss, was Murdoch.
Was Rupert, the owner, Murdoch. The proprietor.
Yeah. What did you think of Rupert Murdoch?
I had a wonderful time working for Rupert Murdoch, and I have the greatest regard for him. I think Murdoch is one of the few geniuses, and I use that term seriously, in the media business. Rupert is just smarter and has more vision and harder working than anybody else. And he anticipated trends, he created trends, and he also was a very good man to work for. He was honest, he was straightforward, and the tougher things got, the nicer he got, which is a mark of character, I think.
Now, he was succeeded by Henry Kravis, who's a famous buyout king, had cut a big swath around on New York. What did you think of Henry Kravis?
Well, Kravis was not really the proprietor in the sense that Murdoch was. Kravis was the head of one of his syndicates, which was called K3, I believe, which bought the Murdoch magazines and a lot of other properties in an effort to establish a big new media company. And Kravis was really the money man behind it rather than the operating director, whereas Murdoch really was responsible for his publications. I mean, he read them and he knew what was in them, and if he didn't like something, you heard about it.
Now, there's a story in here about Kravis talking to you about trying to kill a story in another magazine, and he'll make a deal if that happens, that some story will go into your magazine. It's a Wall Street trade. How did that go?
Well, it didn't go.
Oh.
It didn't happen.
The trade didn't
there
go.
There was a Women's Wear Daily, which was run by John Fairchild, who's a true proprietor, wanted to do a story about Kravis and his wife at the time, Carolyn Rome, and about their lavish ways of living. And Henry wasn't keen on it and wanted me to try to intervene with John Fairchild to get John Fairchild to stop. And I told him to call Fairchild himself.
So that was the end of that.
Who
was your worst publisher?
The publisher I had the most difficulty with was Mort Zuckerman at the Daily News.
And that you went to the Daily News after you left Esquire.
Yes, there was an intervening year or so, and then I went to work for Mort.
And who was your best publisher?
I think Murdoch was the best publisher, although I think Katherine Graham also. And I want to say also that the Hearst people. The company was then run by Frank Bennick, and they are excellent. They are real, real magazine people, and it was a pleasure. I mean, it didn't work out very well for me, but it was a pleasure to work with them. And Kay Graham was totally dedicated to making Newsweek and the Washington Post newspaper as good as they could be. There was never a conversation about budgets. There was never a conversation about alienating advertisers. Her only concern was how can Newsweek be better, fairer, faster, do a better job. Rupert is the most professional who keeps tabs on all his operations, and there are many more now than there were then, but who read the magazine and never made an inappropriate request. In fact, he never criticized.
Did Kay Graham make inappropriate requests?
No. And in the case of Rupert, he would manipulate and has manipulated the political coverage of his newspapers, but none of that ever took place at New York Magazine.
Now, Kay Graham ultimately
put
you
across,
but before we get to that, was this the best part of your, most satisfying part of your magazine career?
Newsweek? It's the part I'm proudest of. I mean, I had the most fun at New York Magazine.
And Newsweek in those days is a lot different than it is today.
I'm sorry?
Newsweek then,
yes,
as a news magazine, had a different position, wouldn't you say? And
Well,
but there are so few media outlets, and they were at that point, and they were at the top.
Oh, of course. Oh, I understand your point. Yeah. No, there was very little national media at that time. I mean, the Times was not a national newspaper in the 1960s and 70s. The Wall Street Journal was essentially a business paper. USA Today didn't exist. And the network news operations were a lot less elaborate than there was. There was no cable TV. There was no news or talk radio. So Newsweek and Time, and to a certain extent U.S. News, were very influential national publications that both reflected and set the agenda of interest then.
And one time you were at a party, trying to take you through your career here,
yes.
And Joe Alsop, who was a famous
yes.
Washington figure, columnist, writer, thinker, meddler, name it, came, and this party was at Kay Graham's house, came up to you and said, "Hey, boy, don't let Newsweek go soft." What does that mean?
Well, for two things. I realized after the fact that Kay Graham's world was a court, and she had a number of courtiers who surrounded her, and she was the queen of the court. They were elliptical. They had all the, in fact, had I read the book of The Courtier by Castiglione, I would have had a better sense of how to operate. So when Joe Alsop, who was one of the main courtiers, took me aside and said that, that was a real message from the queen.
Well, when you went to a Kay Graham party,
yeah.
And you went to Bronx High School of Science.
Correct.
Did you say, geez, I'm a little bit out of place here?
No.
You didn't?
No, I didn't feel that. I enjoyed being there, and I thought I deserved to be there, so I didn't have a problem with
okay,
that.
Okay, so Alsop's trying to send you a message.
Right. Well,
the issue was
that I came to believe, when I was known as the hardest of the hard news people.
What does hard news mean?
Hard news is serious world events, national events, politics, real important policy and developments. I was known as the hardest of the hard news people at Newsweek. But when I took over the magazine as editor in the mid-1970s, I got a very strong gut conviction that the magazines had to broaden their appeal. In those days, Time and Newsweek mostly did political leaders, business leaders, occasionally important novelists or painters. But it was the syllabus was pretty serious. And I felt that there was another kind of news, again, involving trends, like the graying of America and the litigious society. And also at this time, blockbuster movies were developing for the first time since Gone with the Wind. I mean, when The Exorcist came out, or Jaws, these were major popular cultural events. And lastly, a whole new world of entertainers was coming forth. Bruce Springsteen, Steve Martin, John Belushi, and in fine arts, Luciano Pavarotti. These are great stars who are still stars 30 years later, except for poor Pavarotti, who's sick now. And I felt that for the news magazines to survive, they had to embrace a lot more of the things that were going on in the world. And I think I took it a little too far and probably did more entertainment than I should have done. So that's what he was referring to.
So he was worried about the magazine, or Kay Graham was worried about it.
Losing its authority. Because
and being more an entertainment vehicle than a hard news
or
vehicle.
Or seemed to be.
Yeah.
And but in fact, that's the path that they've all taken. I was just ahead of my time.
But maybe too far ahead of
your time.
Far.
Oh, yes. I was 10 years ahead.
You too ahead?
Absolutely.
And so what happened?
Well, on the in a weekend in June, when the Pope was going to Poland for the first time, I chose to put on a cover of Newsweek about horror movies coming up in the summertime. And I did that because the Pope was going to come to America 2 months later, where he was going to have a huge event at Yankee Stadium, and I believe tour the country. And I thought, for Newsweek's purposes, that it would be a lot better to have the Pope in America rather than months earlier. And in any event, it was an unfortunate juxtaposition, and that, I think, was the culmination of her dissatisfaction with me. And so
I guess the thing about your story is, I mean, you had a great career there. You left. You then had another great career at New York Magazine. Esquire was a bit of a downer, but you recovered again
yes.
on the Daily News Amazing.
In fact, she did me a favor, I think.
Really?
Because she opened a whole life to me.
You could do a whole lot of things you wouldn't otherwise do.
Yeah, otherwise it's like being in the Marines or being on the cops. You know, you live your whole life in this closed society. So it was in retrospect, it was painful at the time, but in retrospect, it was a good thing.
Well, let's talk a little bit about what you just indicated, that you were ahead of your time. And now we've come to the point where in the age of the internet, and the issue becomes whether these news magazines, which played an important role in the United States, Time, Newsweek, U.S. News and World Report, are going to make it. And you say in your book, the crisis of confidence that's going on now with respect to magazines is totally technological. And everyone is worried about responding to the net, so news becomes a commodity. What do you mean by that?
Well, what I mean is that news is a wide and deep territory. A lot of news is kind of commodity news, the latest divorce, a plane crash in Russia.
Interchangeable.
Interchangeable, and you can pick that up on when you go to your home page or go to Google News on the computer. You hear it on the radio. You can get it on your cell phone if you want. And so a lot of news is really now just out there, and anybody can propagate it. And there are websites now that just aggregate everybody's stuff. And
okay, well, as long as you talked about a website.
Yes.
You know what I've got here? I've got a little bit of Newsweek's website.
Oh, okay.
And this is what Newsweek is doing to get readers to read Newsweek. And the event I'm going to show you in this internet clip relates to a story that's in Newsweek. So why don't we take a look at it?
Of a story, literally. We have an exclusive behind-the-scenes look at the recently revamped Shamu show at SeaWorld in San Diego. And for the first time in more than two decades, the trainers let a novice in the tank with the killer whales. They put NBC's Peter Alexander through a crash course, to make that a splash course, in orca training. Peter, how'd you do?
Well, we'll find out what you think is the answer to that question. Matt, first of all, this is close enough for most people, but we got in there with her. Why don't we bring her on up, guys? Bring Corky up, if you would. One sec, I'll introduce you to my new friend. She is really the star of the show here, and she's huge, as you can see for yourself. She's the one they put in charge of training the trainers, and one of the first things they taught me, hi baby, how are you, is that she eats about 190 pounds of fish every day.
Hi baby, how are you, Ed Kosner?
It's a whale of a story.
All right, look, what's going on here?
I don't know. It's news to me, as someone once said.
It's news to me.
This is part of the Newsweek website connected to MSNBC,
yeah,
is that it?
It's the Newsweek website.
Yeah, and they're showing clips from NBC?
Yeah, well, they're doing anything that will tie into a story they're going to do on whales, okay?
I see.
All right, so now the question is, what does this tell you about Newsweek today?
Well, it tells me they're being inventive and imaginative, and I don't know whether it's a successful strategy or not. I mean, a lot of my friends are still there, and they're smart people, and they probably have their reasons for doing what they're doing. I don't personally think that that's the direction that news magazines are going to go. But let me make a point.
Are going to go or should go? Because they're already gone.
Well, I mean, ultimately,
this is
we'll
the
wind
reason,
up going.
You know where this tape idea came from? Was that recently there was a big story in the Wall Street Journal saying that this is what the news magazines are going to do to save their hide.
Yeah.
So, you know,
let me just make the point that when I went to work at Newsweek in 1963, there were a lot of stories about the death of news magazines and are they going to make it. And every 3 years since then, like clockwork, those stories have appeared. In fact, I ran many of them at New York Magazine when I was written by a former Newsweek senior editor, Ed Diamond. People have been writing off the news magazines forever.
Right.
And still today, they have a combined circulation of 9 million. They carry a lot of advertising. Time and Newsweek make money. U.S. News perhaps breaks even, maybe makes a little or loses a little. So these, the reports of their death have been premature before, but they are facing a real problem.
Do you read it? Do you read Newsweek?
I look at both Time and Newsweek, but I don't read them closely.
You don't read them?
I don't read them closely.
What do you read?
I read The Economist. I read The New Yorker. I read The New York Review of Books. I read Vanity Fair.
Well, look,
I read newspapers.
Look, you're the former editor of Newsweek.
Yes.
But you don't read the magazine.
No, I don't read it.
Well, then, how can you say that, as you just said a few minutes ago, that reports of their death are premature?
I said they have been premature in the
past. They have been premature.
I said that this is a different crisis that they're facing.
You know what you see? You say also in connection with this that the only way the magazines have survived presently. By putting out exciting scoops, dressing and packaging their news so that journalism can become entertainment. So is that what the future of these magazines are?
No, I don't think so. I think the future of the magazines is
the news magazines
is more analytical. And I think Rick Stengel, who's taken over at Time magazine, has said that that's the direction he wants to go in. Now, 20 years ago, Mort Zuckerman, who I later went to work for at the Daily News, tried to recruit me to edit U.S. News and World Report in Washington. And at that time, I told him that I thought that the magazine should try to become, U.S. News should try to become an American version of The Economist, to give up some of the circulation, but to become the most intelligent, the most analytic of the three news magazines, and appeal to the really highest demographics, the smartest, most important people who needed smart information, that they couldn't compete any other way. That's not the direction that they took.
You have these ideas. You tell them to Mort Zuckerman about The Economist, and The Economist probably is the way Time magazine was in the 1930s and 40s, maybe a little bit the way The Newsweek was at the beginning of your tenure,
a little bit. Yeah.
And you have all these good ideas, and no one listens to them. Maybe you're just old-fashioned. Have you ever thought about that?
That could well be true.
So
it's their problem, though, not mine.
You say that news magazines shouldn't become entertainment magazines.
Yes, I don't think they can survive at that.
Well, now I'm getting to bore in here. If they become entertainment magazines, what happens?
Well, then they're competing with a whole other raft of magazines that are going to be more entertaining.
Well, now you've looked at Newsweek, you haven't read it.
I've read selective articles, but I don't read it regularly and closely every week.
Now, when you look at it for the selective articles, my guess would be you probably read the hard news articles.
That's correct.
And I read a recent survey that the hard news articles in Newsweek are about 15% of the total.
That may be so. I mean, I haven't done that kind of an accounting as I read through it. No, I think that if you're competing with People magazine and In Style and Vanity Fair and the rest, it's a lost cause. A news magazine will never be as entertaining as Vanity Fair. And it'll never be as distracting as People magazine. So I wouldn't go that way.
No, but it seems like, adding up the totals here, we have 85% of the news magazines are not hard news anymore. They're running videos on the websites, which are pure entertainment. I mean, if you were the editor of Newsweek, I suppose you'd have to look at the videos and have something to say about them. So now you're in a position of combining print and the videos. Where is this all going to end then?
Well, remember this. Both Newsweek and Time have new editors. John Meacham is taking over Newsweek next week, I think, and Rick Stengel has taken over Time. They're both very smart guys. John Meacham has written two or three quite important books. Stengel is a very accomplished guy. I think that these two men are going to take these magazines in another direction. I think they're going to be the way. They're going to lead the magazines back.
You think they're going to lead it back?
Back to harder stuff.
Now, if they don't, where is the public, the general public, going to get the kind of information they're able to get out of Time Newsweek? Because we have 4 million people who used to get the hard news when Ed Kosner provided it.
Yeah. Well, and the big problem is that if the newspaper news gathering atrophies, as the papers are, in America, the dirty little secret is real reporting is done by the newspapers, the Associated Press, the news magazines, and a little smattering of other stuff. Everybody else, the electronic media, basically gets their ideas, and certainly the bloggers get all their stuff from newspapers and then proceed to embroider it and give their opinions. If this news gathering atrophies, then everybody's going to be short of hard news, not only readers of Time and Newsweek.
But the elite will get their news.
Yes.
I mean, you say in here that you think...
Because they have to.
They have to.
They have to. They have to know what's going on.
But what does that do to the country, where we have a country that's fully informed by the news magazines, by the TV networks, by newspapers, and now only a selected few?
That's not a recipe for a good political society. I'll tell you that.
Well, so should this title of this book be "It's All News to Me"? Because you covered all types of news, you had entertainment, and it didn't make any difference to you. And in fact, news to you was a commodity, or is that unfair?
No, it was not a commodity at all. It was the heart and soul of what we were doing.
Well, Ed Kosner, I want to ask you the question. Will the news mags make it?
My answer is yes, and they're going to make it in a form that's significantly different. There may only be two of them, not three. They may have smaller circulations than they have now, but I think that when we get together 10 years from now for this show,
be up in heaven,
wherever we do it, you'll find that Newsweek and Time will still be here, and their websites will be a lot better than what you're talking about now.
Two out of the three, which one do you think?
I don't think U.S. News.
U.S. News won't make it.
I think U.S. News is morphing into a kind of a service magazine now. Best colleges, okay, best law schools.
And that was run by Mort Zuckerman,
yes.
So he's got a problem with that.
I think he does have a problem with U.S. News, and they've cut it back extensively.
Ed Kosner.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you very much for stopping by. And thank you for stopping by for The Digital Age. I'm James Goodale. Come back next week and learn more about The Digital Age. Good night.